Let's go to an anonymous caller from Atlanta, Georgia. Hi, what's your question?
Hello, thanks for having me on the show.
You're welcome.
I had a question about the Red Sea crossing.
Yeah, go ahead with your question.
Is there any like evidence for it?
Very good question.
Like any
archaeological evidence or?
Yeah, like with chariot wheels at the bottom.
You hear rumors about that. What do you think, Dr. Barber?
Yeah, you do hear things from time to time about them finding a chariot wheel or some sort of landmark that they can associate with the crossing of the Red Sea. You know, actually, it is actually a debated question where the site is of the crossing of the Red Sea, because as we now have it, the Red Sea actually seems to be bit of a misnomer, is probably more accurately the Sea of Reeds. And where exactly is the Sea of Reeds? Well, that's a more difficult question, and there are different people who have put forth answers. You got to be really careful with claims about, oh, they found a chariot wheel or those kinds of things. You know, first off, if they found something, we would have to know for sure that that was the exact site of the crossing, and we really don't know that location for sure. Secondly, I think you got to be really careful, too, when you hear some of this archaeological news about where it's coming from. Because, one of my concerns as a scholar is that, things actually get properly vetted. Mm-hmm. And the way they get properly vetted is through peer publication in academic journals. And so whenever you hear about a new find, and they call it published by press conference, it's not a good sign, right? It's not a good sign when you publish by press conference. It's really easy to go out and get the media to cover a story and get yourself in the news. As far as I know, and I've looked at this pretty closely, there isn't any clear, unequivocal evidence for the Israelite crossing of the Sea of Reeds. Now, of course, that doesn't mean that the whole story is pure mythology, that there isn't some basis in history for it, but I think you got to be really careful about, things that get cited. Oftentimes, those kinds of stories are examples of published by press conference. But there are discoveries that are really and truly earth-shattering and really noteworthy that are very properly vetted, right?
Yeah. So, can you just talk a little bit about why it's important for some of this stuff to be published in a peer-reviewed journal?
Right, right. So, a lot of claims can be made, and you want to make sure that the artifact itself has been properly traced. There was a big news story came out earlier last year that they had discovered a new gospel fragment. And the gospel fragment was identified as the gospel of Jesus's wife.
That's right. Yeah. Most people have heard about
that. And a lot of people heard about this when the news broke that they discovered this fragment. And it was actually published in the Harvard Theological Review. Amazing.
Karen King.
Yep. Yeah. I'm a well-respected scholar, right? But as people started to pore over the evidence for this, they started to discover that there are some real questions. First off, people weren't able to figure out where this fragment had come from, right? And what we now know is that people are actually quite adept at faking archaeological finds. Yeah. They can take an old piece of papyrus and they can sort of fake the way things were written. They can learn ancient script. And so the way this fragment actually was debunked was an academic blogger noticed that there was a typo, essentially, a grammatical mistake in the language that actually mirrored a publication that came out in English of a sort of ancient gospel of Thomas, not a biblical gospel, and was able to show that it was a fraud, that you wouldn't make this mistake if you knew the language. What somebody had done is they had faked this manuscript, and now, the people who published it have egg all over their face. It's caused scholars, though, now to become a lot more careful because you can sell these fragments, you can sell these finds, and get an exorbitant exorbitant, you know, return on those things. And now, because of that profit motive, there are all kinds of incentive for people to cheat and to.
You know, scholars are human too. Like, I mean, they want to get their name in the press.
Absolutely.
They want to get attention. They want to get students drawn to their program. So, and so there definitely needs to be a lot of caution applied when it comes to any alleged discovery of this nature, whether it's a textual discovery or something from the material culture.
Right.
That's a really great point, Dr. Barber.